Okay, so you're talking about the instruction on self-realization, which is the first chapter of the Ashtavakra Gita, where Janaka said, Master, how is knowledge to be achieved, detachment acquired, and liberation attained? So what is this knowledge with a capital K? It must be pointing to that which is true, the truth. So what is it that we can truly say is the truth? You see? What can we define as the truth? Because this is the only kind of knowledge which will point directly. So that which is unchanging, timeless, which is unchanging, and verifiable. No, what is the point of that which cannot be found directly? You see? Otherwise, if it is not directly verifiable, then it is just like saying that the earth is so much distance away from the sun. You see, we cannot directly verify it, at least not right now, without the instruments. You see? So this ability to find this true knowledge for ourselves must be important, you see. So we are moving away from conceptual knowledge with a small k and moving towards direct recognition of the truth, coming to the knowledge of who we are in the most direct way. So this is knowledge. This is knowledge which I'm presuming that Janaka wanted. Second thing he said was detachment acquired. Who can speak a little bit about detachment?
So it feels like detachment is allowing everything to come and go.
So what would attachment be?
Attachment is when you believe what the mind is offering as an alternative to what it already is.
I simply sometimes also I describe in satsang that attachment is to believe that something that is appearing in this realm is me or mine. So to say that this is me or it is mine, which even to say mine actually implies that there is a me first to be able to call it mine. So this must be attachment to say that this belongs to me, a sense of ownership, my life, my family, my relationships, my money, my spirituality, my freedom. You see? So attachments can be possible only when something seems like it is mine. Okay, so he said this knowledge to be achieved, detachment acquired, and liberation attained. See? So what must this liberation be then? You see? He said knowledge, which is the direct self-recognition, and detachment, which is the letting go of all our attachments. And we've spoken about this in satsang often, isn't it? To recognize the truth and to drop the conditioning, both imply liberation. Just the recognition, a momentary recognition, sometimes is not enough to drop all conditioning. And it is, at least I have not come across a case where conditioning can be dropped without the recognition of what is true happening. Some conditioning can be dropped, but not all, or a majority of it cannot be dropped unless there is a valid recognition. So it seems like the first two are the prerequisites for the third. How is knowledge to be achieved, which means the direct self-recognition to be found, and detachment acquired, which is the dropping of the conditioning. So, verse number three. You are not earth, water, fire, or air, nor are you empty space. Liberation is to know yourself as awareness alone, the witness of these. So he jumps straight in. No? He's saying, you're not earth, water, fire, or air. So in Indian education, in our Indian tradition, the world is made up of these elements, earth, water, fire, air, and space. So he's saying, the sage is saying, you are neither earth, nor water, nor fire, nor air. And then the mind has this tendency, many times in satsang also we see, isn't it? That we start imagining some like empty dark space or black space or some room full of white light is what we are. So nor are you that empty space. It's important to that he mentioned that line very clearly. So I feel we are clear that we cannot be this, the elements of this realm, and neither are we the empty space. Liberation is to know yourself as awareness alone, the witness of these. Very good. So even this space, many times we visualize a space when we are in the inquiry, but who is that that is aware of even this space? This awareness is the true reality of what I am. So when we ask the question, are you aware now? It brings us here, isn't it? To see that this awareness which is here, which is just the witness of all of these elements, but is not made up of any of these elements. It's important to read also that liberation is to know yourself as awareness alone. You see, this is what I've been pointing to also the last few weeks, that sometimes we come to the discovery of awareness as if it is something external to us. Oh, nothing is happening to awareness, but what about me? You see, I have seen this awareness, but what about my life? Will it get better? You see, so still sometimes in our inquiry, in our satsang, it can be that we come to a recognition of this awareness, but something still, the mind still keeps alive the sense of a separate identity, which is coming to the discovery of awareness. You see? So it is important to know, liberation is to know yourself as awareness alone. That's why I've offered you this question, who is aware even of awareness? Okay. And this, I feel, at least right now, if you find a way to escape even this question, then I'll find another question for you. But at least right now, it feels like you cannot truly escape the discovery that I am this awareness. Even prior to I am this awareness. So to know yourself as awareness alone, he's not saying come to the discovery of awareness. Many times in Advaita Satsang, this is what's happening. We come to it as if it is another experience. You must be able to find that it is I that which is this awareness. The I before the I am, or the I, this I is the I that remains, you see, as Bhagwan said. Then he says, abide in awareness with no illusion of person. You will be instantly free and at peace. How does one abide in awareness? The sage says, abide in awareness with no illusion of person. You will be instantly free and at peace. So for me, I would read the second one very importantly, which is with no illusion of person. I feel that the abiding in awareness is our natural state anyway. The only delusion or the only play is this play of being a person. So how do we play this play? We play this play only believing ourselves to be an object within this realm, believing ourselves to be a separate entity. You see, person means what? He's not saying with no illusion of body. Right? With no illusion of person, because the body illusion or reality, whatever you like to call it, can still appear. So what is this person? This is a pure imagination. It is a pure construct. made up of our beliefs. You see? So to abide in awareness with no illusion of person, you will be instantly free and at peace. You can actually just stop here. Because he says you will be instantly free and at peace. If you were just to not fall for the illusion of a person, and we already being in satsang, we know that to abide in awareness is just happening on its own. Can you be unaware? Cannot be. So just this abiding is a natural part. We don't have to, many of us make this mistake of trying to become the awareness, you see. We're trying hard to become the awareness. Can I get myself to be the awareness? But in that we've already picked up the illusion of personhood. You see? So the dropping of the illusion of the person is already the abiding in awareness, because you are aware now. In fact, it would be impossible for you not to be aware. So if I was to say abide in the unawareness, that would be impossible, you see. To abide in awareness is the most natural state. But we have the power, as we know, we have the power to believe ourselves to be a person. This is the illusion of personhood. You see? So he says, to abide in awareness with no illusion of person, you will be instantly free and at peace. So what about conditioning then? Because we've spoken about this, isn't it? What about conditioning then? But even to pick up conditioning requires this, isn't it? The illusion of person, without picking that up right now, can you pick up any conditioning? Very often we've said in satsang that it's all about the right now. Even right now, if you don't tug at the leaf of conditioning, a thought about yourself as a person, you see, then the whole tree has no power over you. You see? So in this moment, right now, you are free. This is what we say in satsang every day. Right now, you are free. You start free. Freedom is not a destination that you're going to. You see? Like I read something very beautiful also from Adya today, where he said, what are you going to do right now to pretend to be unenlightened? I'm paraphrasing. What are you going to do right now to pretend to be unenlightened? That is the real question. What are you going to pick up from the conveyor belt of the mind? You have no caste or duties. You are invisible, unattached, and formless. You are the witness of all things. So we've discussed the person. So unless the person was a reality, it is not possible to have a caste or then the duties of that caste. Then he goes on to describe what you really are. And he starts with, you are invisible. Yeah, is that a big help? You see? Yeah, for those of you who are new to satsang, but then if I'm invisible, then how do I find myself? You see? Because I'm looking for myself and you are saying I'm invisible. So this must be a contradiction, isn't it? So who can tell us why this is not? Also in the hangout you can say something. Why is the invisibility not a contradiction to finding yourself?
Can I say something?
Yes,
yeah. Someone else.
Yeah. I'm just reading this because the self is invisible. Yes, but if it is invisible, then is it possible to find something which is invisible? We are looking for the self, and the pointer is we are invisible. You see? And then Amba said, because you are yourself. Yes, but what does this mean? If I'm Janaka right now, Yes.
Yeah.
But invisible, then how do I find, how do I realize this self? How do I realize myself?
I feel like it's such a beautiful pointer because it completely knocks the mind out of the park right away.
Yes.
Like you just it's have to leave it.
Yes. It's a very beautiful pointer because I say, please imagine something which is invisible. Can you do it?
Space.
Yeah? Can you imagine space? only if you put a room around it. You see, it is not part of the functioning of the mind. Even if you were to imagine space, you'll imagine a dark space. You cannot imagine a colorless space. Imagine something which has no attributes. Can you do it? Actually, take a minute and do it. You can. Something which has no attribute whatsoever. Can we think about it? Can we report something on it? So this invisible actually doesn't mean, I don't know what the original Sanskrit was, but the invisible doesn't just mean invisible in that sense of, you know, the invisible man, but more in the sense of no attribute at all. You see? Because invisible could still mean that it has some weight, it has some mass. You see, here we are talking about that which has no attributes. So, yeah.
As soon as you said invisible, what came to mind was it's not anything you're perceiving.
Yes, exactly.
On any level. Because that's really, for me, I would say the, as much as believing thoughts, yeah, is also the just basically identifying with some vibration, yes, or sensation, yes, or something like that, yeah, which gives weight to the personhood, like the sense of personhood.
Yeah. Yes, but the good thing is, like, Zia posted a quote today where she said that even with sensations, if they are just sensations, it is impossible to identify with them. You see, we must put a label. We must say that this is happening to me. There must be some at least subtle interpretation. You see, because the witness of a sensation is not identified with the sensation. You see? The sensations will still appear, but the identification is possible only. Identification itself means that I have a concept about the sensation. It is impossible to be conceptless about the sensation and yet be identified. You can then only be the witness, actually.